Hello, welcome to our show. It's called That's So Chratheist. Well, what the heck is Chratheist supposed to mean? Well, it's a word I made up. It's a conjunction of two other words, Christian and atheist. And it's to show that Christians and atheists can actually have a dialogue, a discussion that's reasonable and calm and interesting. I think in general in our culture, there's a lot of fire between the two. And so we're going to try to show that there's some respectful communication we can have. My name is Truman A. Smith. I'm a former evangelical Christian. I was raised as a Roman Catholic, and after college I became a born-again evangelical Christian, and I remained one for about 25 years. I even preached the gospel on cable TV, local community access here in Portland. I even founded a part-time 501c3 ministry just for preaching the gospel and putting it on the internet and local TV. In 2009, I left the faith and I became an atheist. And in this show series, what I do is I have a number of guests who are active in some role as evangelical Christians who are experts in some matters of faith and science and religion. Maybe they're apologists that defend the faith, or they're some kind of expert in science and they defend the faith. So this is a special interest of mine because I left evangelical Christianity primarily for scientific reasons. Today my guest is Fazale Rana. His friends call him Fuzz, and he said, I'm his friend, so I can call him Fuzz. So I'll be talking to him as, or addressing him as Fuzz throughout the show. He's a main contributor to the ministry called Reasons to Believe. Their position is called Old Earth Creationism because they accept the age of the earth and the universe according to modern science, which is billions of years old. But like young earth creationists, the young earth creationists say the earth is only about 6,000 or so years old, but what they do have in common with the young earth creationism is that they both reject the idea of macroevolution, that humans evolved from other animals. Fuzz has written many books, and I'll put some of those on the screen as we talk. A partial list would be Creating Life in the Lab, How New Discoveries in Synthetic Biology Make a Case for the Creator. Another one's called Origins of Life, Biblical and Evolutionary Models Face Off. And another one is Who is Adam? A Creation Model Approach to the Origin of Man. And another one is The Cell's Design, How Chemistry Reveals the Creator's Artistry. Welcome to the show, Fuzz.
Well, Truman, thank you so much for having me.
Okay, and our agenda today is we're just going to have a general discussion. And then at the very end, I'll give you, basically I'll have a minute summarization from my viewpoint, and I'll give you a minute to summarize what you think, and I'll let you have the last word there. And then I'm going to take the last minute of the show after that just to introduce the audience to some other opportunities if they want to go to some other atheist meetings where they can do that. So I guess we'll start. And Fuzz, what I'd like to do is give you an invitation. Is there anything else you want to tell viewers about yourself and your credentials? Some people may say, hey, I never heard of this guy. Who is this guy? What are his credentials?
Yeah, well, you know, I consider myself a scientist, though I've not been involved actively in research for about 13 years now, which is the time that I've been with Reasons to Believe. But I did have a career in research and development in industry for a number of years before joining Reasons to Believe. I'm a biochemist by training, and it was actually my study of biochemistry that convinced me that life's basic systems had to be the product of a designer, and that prompted me to ask a series of questions, which led me ultimately to down the path of the Christian faith. And so really I came to faith later in life as a graduate student, began studying chemistry, and it was really, in my mind, the scientific evidence that compelled me towards that end.
Now, you have a Ph.D. in science. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, my Ph.D. is in chemistry, but the emphasis is of my work has been in biochemistry. So I did a biochemistry degree within a chemistry department. So that's my background.
I'm just curious, where did you get your Ph.D. from?
Sure, Ohio University. And then afterwards, I did a postdoc at the University of Virginia, and then another postdoc at the University of Georgia.
Okay, and I'm kind of curious, too. Usually when you get a Ph.D., I think you need to make some kind of breakthrough in science, right?
Ideally, that would be the case. Yes,
okay.
Right?
So it's kind of, what was your specialty when you got your Ph.D.? What did you work on?
Yeah, well, I studied cell membranes, and I, in graduate school, was one of the first people to begin to try to characterize how a newly discovered class of peptides that had antimicrobial activities interacted with the cell envelope of bacteria. And then I continued that type of research in my postdoctoral studies, looking at the interaction of another type of peptide with cell membranes, a peptide called allomethicin. And then I also studied pulmonary surfactant in one of my postdocs.
All right, so you reject evolution. You reject macroevolution, which says that humans evolved from other animals. But you're also an expert in biochemistry. Just a quick question for you on that. If somebody were to claim that, you know, most biochemists would accept evolution and that this macroevolution is, are you familiar with the word null hypothesis?
Yes.
So would you say that macroevolution is the null hypothesis now and within the scientific community?
Yeah, I think that's a fair statement. And I think if you ask most biochemists, most of them would embrace the evolutionary paradigm in its entirety. You know, I am skeptical about aspects of the evolutionary paradigm, the idea that life could come from non-life, a process called abiogenesis. I'm skeptical of abiogenesis or the origin of life being strictly explicable through naturalistic means. I'm, as you mentioned, skeptical of what would be called macroevolution, but there's other aspects of the evolutionary paradigm I readily accept. So it's not all or nothing, if you will.
Well, one reason why I was asking is, would you say that you're in a very small minority of people with your credentials that reject macroevolution?
I think that's a fair statement.
Okay.
But what I also find as I travel around the country and speak at universities is there's a number of people who have comparable training to me who actually privately will express some level of skepticism and some measure of sympathy for the position I hold, but they're not willing to publicly announce that skepticism, if you will, towards the evolutionary paradigm. But again, I think it is a fair characterization to say that my viewpoint represents a minority viewpoint within the scientific community.
Would you say it's a really tiny minority, too, at that?
That's where I'm not quite sure how to quantify that. Again, because in part, a lot of people who are sympathetic to the idea that maybe there is some kind of design imprint within biochemical systems are not willing to publicly announce it. So it's hard to know what those figures are. But it's not a large minority, if you will.
It reminds me of, I think there was a Young Earth creationist group. One time they made a list of scientists that agreed with them that evolution is not right or whatever. And so they had a list of scientists who signed on to that. And not very many were, you know, biology experts. And then I think it was the NCSE that did, or no, it was, I think, Eugenie Scott's group. They kind of did a play on that where they said it was like Project Steve, and they had all these scientists who were just named Steve, you know, and they had like tons of these scientists that, you know, said they accept evolution. So it was all these Steves versus, you know, a hodgepodge of other scientists who were against evolution. Have you heard of that Project Steve?
Oh, yes, I have.
What do you think of that?
I think it's just simply highlighting that, you know, the reigning paradigm within science is, at least with regard to life's origin and life's history, is the evolutionary paradigm. You know, and I think one way to think about maybe why that is the case is because of the approach that many people take to science itself, which is an approach that is undergirded by methodological naturalism, the idea that whether you believe in God or not, when you approach scientific questions, you approach them as a functional atheist, if you will, where you're not going to evoke the role of a creator or any kind of intelligent agency in accounting for life's origin and life's history. And so by definition, in a sense, if you adopt that viewpoint, then you have really no choice but to try to explain life's origin and life's history through evolutionary means. And I find that a lot of Christians in science embrace a methodological naturalism and embrace it in a very vigorous way.
Well, let me follow up on that. So the way I understand it, science by definition is methodological naturalism, and if you extend that to philosophy, then they call it metaphysical naturalism or philosophical naturalism. But as far as science, I thought there's agreement that all scientists call that methodological naturalism. Is that?
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
But the idea behind methodological naturalism versus metaphysical naturalism is in that metaphysical naturalism, you really are thoroughly atheistic in terms of how you approach all aspects of life. Whereas a scientist who embraces methodological naturalism may or may not be a metaphysical naturalist, in that some Christians embrace methodological naturalism when it comes to science, but yet every other aspect of their life, I should say, they actually are theists.
Yeah, so the way I understand it, even like when I was a Christian and accepted evolution, I would say that for science, basically, it's methodological naturalism. Basically, we just consider naturalism only because you can't put God in a miracle or a miracle in an equation. But then that's not all of reality. All of reality, there's also a superset of the spiritual world. And so where we part company is, you believe there's a spiritual world, and I say, no, there's just the material world only, right?
Yeah, that's exactly right. And to be clear, you know, again, I'm a scientist, and I believe that methodological naturalism is a very powerful way to approach the study of nature. So I would not reject methodological naturalism outright, but rather I would adopt what I would call a soft form of methodological naturalism, in that when you begin to study some phenomena in nature, you try to look for naturalistic mechanistic explanations, and only when it looks as if those explanations are not sufficient and that you have other signatures that suggest perhaps the direct involvement of an intelligent agent or a creator, if you will, that at that point you begin to entertain that as a possibility. So, you know, I think methodological naturalism is powerful, and I wouldn't throw it out in its entirety. I just think that it's not entirely sufficient in terms of really studying nature, and particularly when it comes to questions of origins, giving you the full range of latitude in terms of trying to understand the ultimate causation of, let's say, the origin of life.
Okay, so this, I guess that can maybe lead in. How about if I give you a question and you can give me a question? How's that sound?
Okay, that sounds good.
Okay, so I guess my first question will be based on your book. I've read through your book, and not in detail. I mean, it's highly technical, but the one called The Cell's Design, How Chemistry Reveals the Creator's Artistry. Now, I guess here's an overall question I have for you on that book. I would just say it's a big God of the Gaps kind of argument. And so maybe we could have a discussion on that. Why is that not God of the Gaps?
Yeah, you know, that's a really good question. And you know, I would actually agree with the point that you're making, and that is God of the Gap arguments are really not the way any Christian apologist should try to use science to argue for the necessity of a creator. Because we can't explain something doesn't mean it's legitimate to insert God. So I think we would agree on that point. And so what I try to do in The Cell's Design is not really argue that evolution can't explain the features of the cell's chemistry, but rather what I try to do is construct a positive argument saying that the features that we see that characterize the cell's chemistry are identical to the features that we would recognize as evidence for the work of a human designer in a system or an object produced by a human inventor or a human creator. So by analogy, if certain features reflect the work of a mind in human designs, and we see those same features in the cell, then that presents positive evidence that the cell's chemistry is the work of a designer. It doesn't necessarily exclude other explanations, but at least it's saying that these features can positively be understood as the work of a creator. So I would argue that it's, in effect, a form of pattern recognition, which I utilized all the time as a chemist when I worked in research and development in industry is I was involved in using pattern recognition all the time. And so that's what I was attempting to do in the cell design. Whether I was successful or not, of course, is another question, but that was the attempt.
Well, let me give you an example. You know, let's say we can rewind the tape and we can see primitive man. Let's say in the evolutionary viewpoint, I believe that, you know, humans came from other animals, and so at one point, you know, they had a very rudimentary language and not too bright compared to how we are now. And imagine one caveman says to another, you know, we know that when there's a herd of elephants or buffalo coming by here, the ground shakes. We know somebody caused that. And so when there's an earthquake, obviously somebody caused that because there's a pattern. You know, we see this, we know what causes this, and so obviously something really large caused that. And what could be so large? It must be something like a god. But obviously we know that earthquakes are caused by plate tectonics now, and they had no clue about that. So would that be a similar analogy now that somebody might say, well, you say you see some kind of elements of design as a pattern, but it's just like a caveman saying, hey, we know about the ground moving, and obviously somebody made it move, when in fact we now know nobody makes the ground move, it's just plate tectonics.
Yeah, you know, that's interesting. And, you know, I think where the difference would lie would be that, in a sense, that conclusion of design is birthed out of ignorance. And so that really would be a God of the gaps type of conclusion. On the other hand, I would argue that the features that I'm arguing reflect the work of a mind in biochemical systems are based on an increasing understanding of how these systems are structured and how they function. And, you know, there are some instances, for example, like let's say with regard to the genetic code, where you can really make a strong case that chemical evolution is simply not sufficient to account for the extreme optimization that you see in the genetic code.
So maybe we can just talk about that then. I mean, I was going to ask you, what would be an example of something to illustrate? So do you think that's the best example that you have so we can talk about one of these examples?
Yes. If I had to choose an example for design, that would be the most powerful. I would say it's the genetic code.
So now why, can you just real briefly say why you think the genetic code cannot arise naturally?
Sure. Well, I mean, first of all, the positive argument for design would be, and I'll go real quickly here, is that the fact that the code is in effect, basically a code. We, from our common experience, we know that codes come from minds, and the heart of biochemistry is, in effect, the genetic code. It defines biochemistry itself. And it turns out that the code is exquisitely optimized to withstand errors that would result from substitution mutations. And in fact, this has actually been quantified by researchers over the span of several years. The work was culminated in the early 2000s, but they published a series of papers showing the extreme optimization of the genetic code. And there was a famous paper written by Francis Crick called On the Origin of the Genetic Code, where he argued that the genetic code could not be a frozen accident because once the code was in place, any kind of change to the code would be catastrophic and lethal to life. And so he argued the code had to be a frozen accident, that the code was not capable of evolving. But on the other hand, you have now this discovery of extreme optimization, which indicates that from an evolutionary perspective, there had to be sufficient evolution of the code, significant evolution of the code, in order to achieve that optimization. And so you wind up with this essentially competing set of ideas that essentially cancel each other out. And then on top of that, you have what I believe to be powerful fingerprints for design, encoded information, plus the extreme optimization of the code.
Well, let me kind of go on to a related thing, because the DNA code is actually one reason why, as a Christian, I accepted evolution. And I'm sure you're familiar with Dennis Venema's he's a scientist who's an evangelical Christian, and he gave the evidences for evolution, and we talked about that on a previous time.
Yes, I remember.
So, you know, for example, when you compare the code across species, and, you know, and he gives the example for, I believe it was for insulin, the gene, you can see, okay, we know that there's a gene is made up of a series of amino acids, and every amino acid is called for by a codon, a three nucleotide sequence. And it turns out that there's more than one nucleotide sequence that could code for a certain gene. So for in other words, there's no such thing as a perfect gene or a perfect code because there are so many different alternates you can use. And it turns out when you compare across species, we can see how the same code is used and sometimes see some of the bits changing. So, you know, when I saw that, I mean, to me, that looked like it was obvious descent. And so I don't understand why you don't see that as obvious descent. You know, since there are so many different codons that could have been, so many sequences that could have been used, but they all use very similar ones.
Yeah, right. You know, that's, I would agree, that type of argument in terms of making a case for common descent is actually a very powerful argument. You know, but what's going on here with whether it's that particular argument that you're discussing in terms of codon usage within a gene, let's say, or whether it is shared pseudogenes, shared endogenous retroviruses, you know, the list can go on and on. Fundamentally, what's being argued here is that you have these shared DNA sequence patterns, or you have shared structures within the genome that reflect, again, common ancestry or common descent. And the argument is, well, these features must have arisen in a common ancestor, and as the two lineages diverge, those particular features are retained within the genome. Their fingerprint is retained within the genome. Now, in order to fundamentally, though, interpret that as evidence for common descent, there are two major assumptions that you're making. One is that those structural features or those sequence patterns are not functional, because if they are functional, you could argue that those represent a design feature, a common design element.
But Fazale, let me interrupt you for a little bit. I mean, that's a good discussion to have on pseudogenes. You're starting to go down about pseudogenes, but let's talk about specifically, as I mentioned earlier, that there are alternate codon sequences to get an amino acid, and there are so many different possibilities to create a gene. There's no such thing as, like, this is the perfect insulin gene, because there's alternate codings. There is no preference. But it turns out that all these animals, you can see a sequence of how they're related. So why, I don't understand how, I know you know that, so I don't understand why you don't draw the obvious conclusion that these are, that there's descent there.
Yeah, well, in a sense, that argument is that Dennis Venema is presenting is somewhat simplified, and you're right, and he's right that you can have a large number of possible codons that could be used to represent a particular gene, and they would produce the equivalent protein in terms of the protein's amino acid sequence. But some things that are being discovered are that all codons are not equivalent in terms of the type of protein they ultimately produce. In other words, the precise codon that are used to specify a amino acid sequence can actually influence the rate of protein synthesis at the ribosome. This process is called translation, and it can either speed it up or slow it down. And as it either speeds up or slows down, it actually alters the way the protein folds off the ribosome. And so you can have the same amino acid sequence actually generating proteins with two different three-dimensional structures and consequently two different functional capabilities.
Wait a second, though. Wouldn't the structure have to be the amino acids are the same amino acids regardless of how they're coded, because once they're, you have alternate codons that can pull out an amino acid. So once you get the amino acid, it's going to fold exactly the same, regardless of what the codons were.
Well, it exactly. In an ideal sense, if you're thinking about it from a thermodynamic standpoint, the minimum energy structure is good for that amino acid sequence when it folds into three-dimensional space is going to be the same, but you're looking at a kinetic effect. In other words, as the protein is coming off the ribosome, depending on the rate of translation, as the protein begins to explore different folding patterns, different folding folded structures, it's going to go through localized minima and maxima, but that kinetic effect is actually going to trap it into certain folding patterns based on the rate of translation. And so it's a kinetic effect, not a thermodynamic effect, and it's actually producing proteins with alternate folding. And, you know, I don't have references to some of the papers that have discovered this, but I did write about it on our website at reasons.org, and so those articles that I wrote describing that work give reference to the original literature, so you know, people can check up on that if they'd like. But I think that the point I'm making is that it's not completely true that the types of codons used in a gene are necessarily equivalent, even though they may specify the same amino acid sequence. And so I think the argument that Venema is making on the surface is a very powerful argument, but it's a simplified argument that doesn't take into account
all
that we know about biochemistry.
Okay, well, let me ask you it this way then, just to drill down a little bit more. So we know when you look at the lookup table, there's a codon sequence that will pull out an amino acid. So sometimes you have two options. Sometimes, what's the most you have, like three or four options maybe for one amino acid?
I think that there may be some amino acids that have up to six codons that specify them.
Okay, so yeah. So let's say you have six different patterns that can pull out an amino acid. Now, are you saying that, for example, there's only one of those that would actually work? Or could you say maybe there's even two out of those six that might work, or even maybe three out of the six? Are you saying it has to be one out of six that would work?
No, I think, all six of them would code that same amino acid, but because those codons have different, nucleotide sequences, they're coding triplets, that when they're being read at the ribosome through the process of translation, processivity of the messenger RNA through the ribosome will increase or decrease depending on the particular codon.
I understand what you said there. So are you saying the bottom line is that then, in order to really work, because of what you're saying, are you saying that only one of those alternatives would actually work, or how many different alternatives would there be?
No, two? I see what you're saying. No, they all would work.
No, but they wouldn't work because you just said it wouldn't fold correctly.
Well, I may have misspoke. It would fold in alternate ways, and those two alternate folding structures would actually produce proteins that would have different functional attributes. And so, depending upon the particular set of codons used, the same amino acid sequence can actually yield multiple functional proteins that have different three-dimensional shape.
Well, let me rephrase it. Let me rephrase it like this way in a thought experiment. Suppose I'm a mad scientist and I have high technology tools, and I take the human DNA code, and I take that codon pattern, which all humans pretty much share, and I just change one of the bits. Do you think, and so now it's an alternate coding, do you think if I chose another bit that the humans would be all messed up, or do you think you would still get a human in the same exact shape and everything?
Yeah, I think it could be you'd get either a human, without much effect, or there very well could be a significant consequence. This is, in a sense, something that biochemists at this point don't really know. The full range of how prominent this phenomena is, or how broad-reaching the implications of it are. In other words, this is something that is just being discovered that I think raises questions about whether or not codon usage and shared codon usage actually represents as powerful a case for common descent is being advocated by Dennis Benema and other people who would make that argument.
Well, because I mean, here's the deal. Like, for example, if you could change that bit, and let's say you really did have two choices or maybe three choices, that is saying that they are true alternatives because they basically have the same end product. If that were true, then I think it seems like this is an argument for dissent, because what you see is that this is what happens, is that we do share this code and we don't see these alternatives. And so then you would say, well, if there really are alternatives but God didn't use them, you might say, well, God is just reusing a good design. But on the other hand, it looks like he's purposely, if things did not evolve, it's like he's purposely trying to deceive us, because it's, you can see the footprints as if things did evolve. So.
Yeah, I see your point. And, I think you would argue that God is purposely trying to deceive us if indeed the use of different codons really had no impact on protein structure in terms of its three-dimensional structure, not its primary sequence. And so I think you would be correct if indeed these discoveries had been made, but the fact that these discoveries have been made suggests to me that you could truly understand this as being the work of a creator who isn't trying to deceive, but as we have more information, we begin to see, wow, this is a really efficient way of creating variability within biological systems by simply doing very minor alterations in the genome. And this goes back to the point that I was making earlier, is that when you interpret shared features as evidence for common descent, you are making an assumption that those shared features are not functional.
Well, yeah, let's not go there, because that's a different argument, and that would take more time. I just wanted to talk about this one for now, about the codon coding, and then maybe mix it up a little bit. Do you have a good question for me, and then just to mix up the program a little bit?
Yeah, sure. I think it goes back to a point we kind of began discussing, and that would be related to this whole idea of methodological naturalism, because my question would be, do you believe that by adhering to a strong form of methodological naturalism, that is, in a sense, restricting the capacity of science to discover the truth? And is it possible that what we perceive as being really powerful evidence for common descent is actually evidence that seems to be powerful because there's not really a legitimate alternative that's being offered, and that is essentially not being allowed because of the philosophical undergirding of science?
Well, I guess I'm not sure what you mean by limiting science, because it sounds like if you thought science was not limited, then what you would like to do is, it sounds like what you're asking for is to put God in equations. You want to have a scientific thesis that says God did a miracle? Is that what you're advocating?
I would like that to be allowed.
But how can you test it?
Well, I think there's a lot of ways to test whether or not a creator was involved.
Well, that's one of the arguments against intelligent design, is that, you would say, well, we know what the patterns are, and therefore, if there was a mind that did it, they would do the same patterns. But one of the arguments is that, well, really what we know is we know what humans do for design, but we don't know what, if there's some kind of disembodied spirit that's a god, we don't really know what he would do. I guess you're assuming that he would think like we think as a mind, but we don't have...
Yeah, that's a very good point that you're bringing up. And in fact, I address that in the cell's design, where in effect I make that very same point, is that we do have one example of how designers operate, and that would be human beings. That's an unequivocal example.
Right. So that would tell us. So that would tell us whether human beings design something or not. But so
right.
I guess it's hard to speak for God when nobody knows anything about God for sure. I mean, everybody has their own ideas. Some people think there's many gods, one God, no God. You know.
Exactly. I agree with that point. And what I do in the cell design is basically say, if we take the idea that is taught in the Judeo-Christian scriptures that human beings are made in God's image, then what we could argue is that if it's the God described in the Bible, then we would expect that what human beings do is in effect a mirror or a mimic of what that creator does. And so,
okay.
In a sense, it doesn't really address that concern from a non-biased perspective, but rather it's basically saying if we argue that the creator is specifically the God described in Scripture, and we take into account this idea human beings are made in God's image, then we could argue that what human beings do would be a reflection of the creator described in the Bible, but that's, in a sense, what limits that particular approach that we take in the cell design.
Mm-hmm.
But in a broad sense, you know, science does have the capability, does have the tools in the toolkit to detect intelligent activity. That's, for example, the whole point of SETI is to be able to distinguish between signals that are emanating from intelligent agents versus signals that are emanating some kind of natural phenomena within the universe.
Well, okay, well, let me get back to your question. Do I think science is too limited if we don't consider God? You know, I guess part of me feels like, well, you know what, if you really think that there's evidence for that, I kind of appreciate the work of ID people trying to establish that. On the other hand, I can see how this ID is a sign stopper. For example, if you are really convinced that God created humans by an act of a miracle and not through evolution, then it would be foolishness for you to study scientifically how humans could have evolved. So in other words, it's a sign stopper, because why would you try to investigate something that you know God did? Now, for example, you know, it reminds me, you know, the old story about Laplace. I think he came to Napoleon and said, here's my idea about how the stars and the planets move. And so Napoleon says, well, where's God in this? And he goes, well, I have no need for that hypothesis. So, I mean, if people would have thought, oh, well, God is the one moving the stars around and everything, nobody would have went further to find out really what, you know, all these ideas about gravity and general relativity and all this stuff. So, I mean, to me, I see the obvious sign stopper there. We continually thought, well, this is a miracle. Oh, I guess not. Oh, this is a miracle. Oh, I guess not. So it's always just one after another. That's the history of breakthroughs in science.
Yeah, you know, that's a common objection to intelligent design, is that it would be a science stopper. And I don't really see it that way. To me, I think what it does, let's say if you evoke a design hypothesis, it just, I think, produces a different set of questions or may emphasize certain questions at the expense of other questions. So, for example, you know, if you think that God is responsible for bringing life into existence, there still would be very powerful motivation for studying biochemical systems just simply to see, you know, what exactly did the creator do, to think the creator's thoughts after him. But then if the creator is actually generating designs in nature, there would be a lot of motivation to understand those designs for practical reasons, because that then gives us a blueprint or a pattern to develop our own designs, if you will, and to create technologies with those designs that are present in nature. And it's interesting that there's a whole area of engineering known as biomimetics, where engineers are actually doing that very thing. And I think that practice fits more naturally within a design framework as opposed to an evolutionary framework, where you're arguing evolution creates the designs in nature, but those designs very well could be suboptimal. So I'm not completely convinced the science stopper argument is completely valid.
Well, it's like this. Suppose the scientific establishment believed as you did, that humans were made as a miracle and not evolved from other animals. That means, you know, if that was the thrust of the whole scientific community, then when somebody said, hey, I want to study evolution, and I think I have some tests here to figure out what happened here, they would look at them and say, you're wasting your time. Why would you waste your time on something like that?
Yeah, well, you know, in a sense, that's what the scientific community has said about design, is that, of course, we accept the idea that evolution explains life's origin and life's history, so why would you want to explore this idea that is more reminiscent of Paley than Darwin, because we've already eliminated design as a possible explanation. Yet on the other hand, the evolutionary paradigm has not been very successful at all. In fact, it's been arguably an abysmal failure when it comes to trying to account for the origin of life through chemical evolution. I mean, in a sense, there's been 60, 70 years of intense work on this problem, and there's really been no genuine progress made since Stanley Miller's day.
This is one difference I got from being, when I was a Christian, I think being a Christian is kind of easier to fall for a God of the Gaps argument, because I think the mentality goes like this, that, you know, we are really smart, and if we don't understand something, then obviously something smarter than us made it, and that'd be like God. But there's, the more I learned about science, I think the more humble I've got, and for one thing, I've learned there's so much out there that I don't know, so I really had to dig deep. And for another thing, I've learned that there's a lot that science doesn't know. For example, you know, what dark energy and dark matter is. That's why they call it dark, because they don't know. So I think part of the problem is thinking that we are so smart that if we don't know it, obviously something smarter made it. I mean, it's kind of like, again, look at the cavemen. They're sitting around arguing about who made earthquakes. Well, they're ignorant. They don't know what they're talking about. And in the same way, you can look at us as humans and saying, yeah, of course we don't know how life evolved. Why is it? Because we're still ignorant. We know how to deal in this four-dimensional world, you know, space, the length, width, height of space, and then also time. But, you know, in string theory, they posit maybe there's 10 dimensions. How could we, you know, of course we don't know this stuff, because we're like as dumb as cavemen, you know? So I wouldn't be surprised. I don't think it's a surprise that we don't know things. I wouldn't say it was an abysmal failure. I'd say we're trying to get closer and closer as time goes on. Do you see the difference about looking at it as a failure versus trying to come up to speed?
Yeah, but let me address that point specifically with regard to the origin of life question. I would not... I want to make sure, even though I'm saying I think origin of life research has been an abysmal failure, it doesn't mean that I don't have the utmost respect for the scientists that are involved in that work. We're looking at this problem from an evolutionary perspective. In fact, I would argue that these scientists have been successful in identifying that principle. There are chemical reactions and physical processes that can generate life's building blocks, that can assemble those building blocks into functional molecules, and they've worked out the mechanisms for how these processes work. But where they have failed is showing that chemistry can translate from a laboratory setting where they've discovered the chemistry to the conditions of the early Earth. And you can actually show through rigorous experimentation that as soon as you move from conditions that are pristine laboratory conditions to the conditions that most certainly would have existed on the early Earth, the chemistry no longer is productive. In fact, it's frustrated, and in some cases, it's not even possible on the early Earth. And so what they've shown is that the chemistry works in laboratory settings when you are evoking intelligent agents to oversee the chemistry, but as soon as you go to uncontrolled situations, again, the chemistry doesn't work. Mm-hmm. And in fact, this is a conclusion that's not my conclusion, but rather a conclusion that's been drawn by origin of life researchers themselves. And I can give you statements made by a number of prominent scientists that are involved in the origin of life where they basically make the effect that, or sorry, make the statement to the effect that, for all intents and purposes, the hand of researchers represents the hand of God, and that, again, we've not made any kind of real progress because of this problem of translating it to the conditions of the early Earth. So this is a situation where I believe that you could argue that maybe insisting on the evolutionary paradigm is actually the science stopper, not exploring the possibility that maybe a designer was involved in some way.
Okay. How about let's in order to try to mix it up a little bit more, what I'd like to see if we can do maybe two more topics. I'll have a question or topic for you, and then you can have one for me, and spend about 4 minutes on each one of these.
Sure.
Because we only have about 12 minutes or less, actually about 8 minutes or so. So one thing I'd like to ask you about is Noah's Ark. So as an old Earth creationist, the way I see your view is you call it, you say there was a local flood that... Basically, there was a local flood, and Noah built an ark, and he saved the animals, and all the humans at that point were in a local area, so this flood destroyed all the humans except for those that were on the ark. And to me, that just seems really strange because, first off, it seems like the story is obviously there's a worldwide flood. It seems like it goes to great detail to try to explain it's a global flood. It says it even covered the highest mountain. So why wouldn't you believe it was a global flood? Well, because we both agree there's no evidence for a global flood. So you say it's a local flood. But then I think the problem for a local flood is, number one, why build an ark? It seems like God should just tell Noah to get the high ground. And number two, why would you save animals like a bird? It says to save the birds on there where birds could easily fly away. So it seems like it really... And then three, how could water even... get trapped in a local area like that? It seems like the rivers are constantly draining it. So, I mean, for all those issues, it just seems like logically a local flood wouldn't make sense. And I guess another objection, too, would be that we know how ancient humans are. I mean, they must have spread out all over as far as they can get on the Earth. They wouldn't just be some local area. So it seems like there's many ways it doesn't seem logical to think there's a local flood. So
yeah,
your response,
I mean,
there?
You know, given that we're running short on time, I'll give a very quick answer. And all the questions that you ask are very good, legitimate questions. And these questions have been addressed by my colleague, Dr. Hugh Ross, in a book called The Genesis Question. And there's also material on our website that also addresses those questions. And I would agree with you that when one looks at the text superficially, it does look like it is describing a global flood, but when you actually dig into the original Hebrew, it's not as clear-cut as that. And in fact, there's a number of biblical clues within the flood account, as well as statements outside of Genesis, like in Proverbs and in Psalms, that actually indicate that the flood is probably best understood as being a local flood, not a global flood. And in terms of the water being confined to the Mesopotamia area, there is a scientist who's written an article for us that's on our website where he explains, based on the geography of that region, how something like that would actually be possible, how a local flood like that would be possible.
Does that make sense to you? Because it seems like the rivers would be constantly draining it. How could you trap water?
Well, I'm not an expert in geography. And there's an article, again, on our website that actually provides a detailed explanation looking at the very things that you're bringing up. So the point I would make is that it's not scientifically outlandish to actually argue that you would have had some kind of significant local flooding in the Mesopotamia area that would have been due to some kind of cataclysmic release of water from aquifers as well as heavy raining. So anyway, I mean, I think there's ways to address that question scientifically.
What about saving birds? Why would you want to save a bird if it could easily fly away from a flood?
Yeah, that's a good question. And as Dr. Duos points out, that when you look at the text carefully, what's being asked of Noah is to take certain animals on board that would be used for sacrifice as well as be used to help establish human civilization, if you will, after the ark lands, after the flooding ends. And so it wasn't really designed to save animals, but rather it was meant to be essentially provisioning for Noah and his family after the flood.
What about the text where it specifically says that every creature that had life, a breath in it, or, you know, would breathe, was destroyed unless it was on the ark? It, you know, it says that in the text.
Yeah, that's where in the original Hebrew, the word that's translated earth can actually mean not only the planet, but also a local area or a piece of land. And so that word in the original Hebrew is eretz, and it can mean the entire world, but also can mean the land. And so you could see that text as saying that the water destroyed, flooding happened, and the water destroyed every animal in the land. So it wouldn't necessarily have to be a global phenomena, given the nature of the original Hebrew.
Okay, well, it just seemed to me like the obvious point of the story was that they put the animals on there to preserve them, and they said, you know, if they weren't on that ark, then they were destroyed. So you're saying the reason was not to preserve the animals, because, I mean, obviously, there's no point in preserving them from a local area. There's plenty of diversity all through the world, right?
Right.
So
yeah,
you're
yeah.
saying so you're saying the primary point of the story was not to preserve the animals.
Right. It was to bring those animals on board for provisioning and for sacrificial purposes.
Okay. So in about 3 minutes or so, do you have a question for me again?
Yeah. I guess my question would have to do with the question of free will. So let's change gears significantly. I mean, my question would be, do you believe that free will is real, or is it an illusion? And if it is an illusion, that means that everything about us is ultimately determined. It would be a strong form of determinism. And if that's the case, then it would mean that you're an atheist, not because of some kind of rational liberation at the end of the day, but because of deterministic effects. And it would mean that I'm a Christian, not for rational reasons, but for some type of deterministic effects, which means that we would never really be able to discover the truth. And if that's the case, then how can we be sure that anything is true? And so it seems to me that from an atheistic perspective, it in a sense is self-stultifying, if you will, because of this idea of free will and determinism.
Yeah, I think free will is actually it's tempting to be superficial about that, and there are some other viewpoints. I think one's called compatibilism, but let me give you a rudimentary example. Suppose you heard about the Google car that can drive itself, right?
I haven't, but that sounds interesting.
Okay, there's this. Google's had this car that's been driven for a couple years, test driving. It's never got an accident yet, except for when they had a person driving it. But basically, it's got cameras all around it. It can see all around, even it's got like lasers and infrared stuff, and it can even see cars ahead because it can see, it has better visibility and all this stuff. And it's making decisions about, you know, when to slow down, when to speed up, and all this stuff. So I guess in a rudimentary way, you can see how that's making decisions. And as an atheist, I believe, you know, we have a meat-based computer. So you've heard of the idea of emergence, right?
Yes.
So basically, I would say the mind is an emergent property. And so it's not just all, you know, so you don't try to explain the mind in terms of atoms, because there's emergent things that are in between the two. You know, like when you put A and B, you get C. And then and when you got two other things, you got E. And then those two combine, and they create all these emergent properties. So I think all these emergent properties are very complex. So I can see how, you know, we can make decisions just like a computer would. Should we turn left or right? And I think, you know, like I said, this Google car is a rudimentary example. We also have the Watson computer that can beat somebody at, is that the one I think it beats at Jeopardy? Yeah, and then we have Deep Blue that can beat the chess players. And I'm thinking if you put all these three apps together, you know, you still have a rudimentary computer that can make choices and decisions, and you'd probably swear that this thing has a soul because you can talk to it, but yet it's just a silicon-based computer, and we're a meat-based computer. So there's some similarities and differences there.
I mean, do you think then that free will is an illusion?
I believe we can make choices because of our thinking capabilities from our mind, which arises from our brain.
Okay, so what you're saying is because you think the mind is an emergent property that we are able to have genuine free will, and so it mm-hmm. things are not ultimately strictly deterministic then.
Well, see, and part of the free will too is we have some choices to freely pick out of a limited subset too. Like, for example, because I'm a male, there are certain choices I have available to me, and because of the way I was brought up, there's certain choices I had to pick from. There's a really interesting guy on the internet named Darren Brown. He's a mentalist, and it's funny how he has the power of suggestion. It looks like he's doing miracles, but he knows what you're thinking because of the way he manipulates the mind. But we're kind of out of time there. Would you like to just give a 30-second, I'll give a 30-second summary, and then I'll invite you to give a 30-second summary, okay?
Sure thing.
So anyway, my 30-second summary is I really appreciate this time with you. I was looking forward to this. I like you as a person. We have a lot in common. And I just want to end it with that. We barely scratch the surface on these things, and that's just the way it goes. But anyway, I just want to say I appreciate our talk, and I'm glad we know each other and you decided to do this. So.
Well, Truman, I would echo the same thing that you said, as I really enjoy the interactions that we had. I enjoy getting to know you better, and I like you as a person, and I really applaud your desire to try to have vigorous dialogues with people of differing perspectives, but doing it in a way where we not only respect each other, but like each other and want to learn from one another. And it's unfortunate that there's not more discourse in our country along those lines. So I really applaud the project that you're doing here, and I'm honored that you would invite me to be part of it.
All right, thank you for coming on the show. Now, just for our viewers, I want to let you know that if, for example, you're a Christian or atheist and you want to meet other people in the Portland area, sometimes, you know, if you're a Christian, sure, it's easy to find another church, but if you're an atheist, how do you find other people? Well, I want to tell you about meetup.com. It's a website where you can go there to find people of any kind of similar proclivities, you know. For example, if you like horseback riding, you can find people that are into that. So if you're an atheist, you can go to meetup.com, you can search for atheist or agnostic or whatever, and put in your zip code, and it'll show you all the groups that are meeting in the Portland area. Just to tell you some, there's one called Humanists of Greater Portland. They're a chapter of the American Humanist Association, which is AHA. So that's one on meetup.com. There's another one called Center for Inquiry, the Portland chapter of that. There's another one called Flying Spaghetti Monster Lands for a Pint. There's another one called Atheists, etc. And Portland State University has a group called the PSU Freethinkers, if you attend Portland State. And that's just a partial list. None of them have anything to do with the show, but I'm letting you know about meetup.com, where you can find other people of similar interests. So thanks for tuning in, and I hope you enjoyed the show, and we'll have fun next time.